Hello, hello. All right. We'll wait for the notifications to get out to everybody. Welcome, welcome. Christy! Hey, gorgeous. How you hanging in there, sis? Oh. There we go. There's Anne Marie. Oh, this is so exciting.
Hey, Christy.
Hey.
I have had to switch up what I did, Christy, from what I told you I was doing. It's probably 10 times worse now, but hey.
Oh, hey, Sarah. Oh my gosh.
I even switched
This
it
is
from when I
really
talked to
exciting.
you, Amy. I even switched it from when we just got off.
Oh my gosh.
So, oh well.
You still look
I can't see, so I'm gonna have to put these on. I was avoiding the glare, but
It's all good.
I
It feels like we haven't done this forever, so I'm like excited.
was thinking it was probably July 9th when we mentioned that today. It was like, wow, that's been forever, forever. You know,
Yeah.
and I don't like that it's been that long, but you know. Sometimes when things come up against us, we have to go into the quiet.
Exactly. I definitely don't fight it anymore like I used to. But this quiet, I mean, this is what we're going to be talking about tonight is that, you know, this season of quiet that Anne Marie and I have been experiencing hasn't been that quiet, and I, you know, we just really felt like there's been a lot of people that have been dealing with this as well. So it's like, you know what, why suffer in silence, right? And you know, we can build each other up and encourage each other, and you know, you're not in this, you know, warfare or any of this alone. So I'm gonna let Anne Marie kick it off and just say hey to everybody that's jumping on and
Okay. Yeah, just
welcome.
continue to greet. I'm trying to do something with my settings. I'm sorry, I'm having a little bit of trouble here, just real quick, but just give me a sec and I'll be okay.
Yes, we will definitely be praying for that, Aubrey, and I'll be making notes because we'll do some prayer time towards the end as it allows. And I'll write it down right now. Because I want you to feel forgotten.
That's right.
All right.
Okay. Hey, Kim. Yay.
Hey, Karina. Hey, Kimmy. Welcome, welcome.
One of the things that we were just talking about when we were just starting this off tonight was about the fact that it has been so long. And sometimes, I quit my school job about 2.5 years ago because God spoke to me and wanted me to write. Now, I've been writing for 2 years, but I haven't necessarily put it into what, that vision was that I have seen him give me of what he wants me to do. And it's been really frustrating that it seems that the enemy keeps stealing either my time or my resources that can make my time, to be able to find that. So, I really had to kind of go within. And both of us really struggled with that. I know Amy did, and I did, that we could not, be on here in this family atmosphere and communicating with the folks that we love that are surrounding us. But we worked through this, and we're like, last time we actually tried to go on about a month ago, wasn't it? And we had so many technical difficulties that we just felt that it wasn't good timing. And a lot of good stuff has come out of that. But the big thing is that the biggest message that I've been getting is seek first the kingdom of God. And that's just been something that's been resonating in my spirit. And it's something that, that we know, and we've talked about it in about almost every aspect of it, maybe not with those exact words, but where, you know, that's what we need to do, whether it's the quiet place, whether it's in his presence, like what we were saying in one of our lives, or like in this time. Like, the reason these words are so profound to me right now is that in every moment, not just to go into the quiet, not just to have our prayerful time and things like that, but seek first the kingdom of God in every single thing that we do. And that means every decision we make, every step we take, to be able to be walking in his will. And, you know, we were kind of, Marty and I were kind of falling into a place of being set up for breakthrough on September 1st in many areas. And it's when literally it was like a bomb went off and everything, you know, flew in every direction. And it felt like a tornado had just kind of wiped out every direction of our lives. And I'm talking like health things, finances. We recently had a death of what I would consider a family member this past week. And every single thing that we've had to seek the kingdom of God first, seek him first. And it's been a terrifying thing. A few of the things have been pretty terrifying, and we've had to, you know, draw near to him and make sure that we're listening to every single word he says and every way he speaks. And I've shared some things this week of some pretty profound things that have happened, but this just leads us back into the last thing that we wrote right after, I guess, our last broadcast, when we talked about the burning bush. And it all ties together. Everything's tying together from that point till now. So it's almost like it's all come together for this broadcast for us to talk about. And so I'm going to pass to Amy real quick, but that's kind of where, you know, that's where this has brought me, is to seek first the kingdom. And it kind of goes back to all everything that we've been saying all along, but just in a more profound way, every moment of the day.
Yeah. And, you know, and in the midst of, you know, kind of this battle season and this seclusion, you know, the Lord's really been pressing on me, you know, the whole burning bush moments, the burning bush. I can't even talk tonight. Burning bush encounters. And I feel like, you know, since we first talked about that, and I think, you know, we wrote about it as well. I've had multiple moments over the last few months where I've just really had these moments where I've just felt like the Lord's, you know, just fire just kind of burning within me, you know, burning stuff off. You know, it's always, you know, there's always something that he, you know, reveals to us in the midst of that. And over the last few weeks, you know, I've had, you know, that this word emerging, and the purifying that the Lord is doing, not just corporately with the church, but us individually. He's purifying us, you know, because, you know, like with a company, when you're going for a job, that job is going to have specific requirements for you to even be a candidate for that job position. And the Lord just really paralleled that for me with this new season. You know, we're all talking about and excited about this new season, this emerging, this coming out of this old year, this old season, all this stuff. But yet there is a requirement being placed on us in order to do that. You know, we all want that new thing. We all want that big dream, that big vision. But a lot of us have been shying away from the purification and the qualification process in order to achieve it, in order to emerge out into it. And as I was sitting here, you know, just kind of praying about, you know, this broadcast, and I knew the Lord really wanted me to talk about those burning bush encounters and how you have to seek it out. You know, I mean, Moses was just, you know, a foreigner living in the land, doing the job that was required of him, but it wasn't what he was called to do. And when he was out and about and he saw the bush burning, but then he made a conscious choice and effort to seek it out and to actually go look at it. And that's when the encounter happened. And I really feel like there've been so many of us that have just kind of given up because it's been intense, yes. Because the war has been intense. And, you know, when things get really bad, we do just kind of like want to throw our hands up and surrender and say, gosh, I can't deal with this anymore. But there's something that happens in the spirit when you decide to say, even though I feel like I can't go on any further, I'm still just going to keep going. I'm still going to keep trusting you. And then boom, something happens. And that encounter, like with Moses in the burning bush, you know, the voice of God spoke out like, take off your shoes. You're on holy ground. I mean, there's something that happens when you cross from the fear and the exhaustion into an encounter. And part of that emerging, as I was just kind of soaking on that today, I had a vision, and I know I shared a part of this, I think in a previous writing, but the vision that I had today was a little bit different. I saw, you know, people, you know, kind of stepping out of these caves, and as soon as they stepped out, all of a sudden they just had like this massive onslaught of attack. And I feel like that is exactly what has been happening. That's a perfect picture of what's been happening to those of us coming out of our quiet season, out of our cave season, out of that prison, the pit, you know, all of those metaphors of just kind of being hidden away. And now you know, and you feel this emerging that the Lord's doing with you. But then all of a sudden, as soon as you stepped out, boom, you started getting attacked again. And here's what I'm going to share. I wrote this down so I didn't mess it up. So with all the opposition, you step out of the cave and now you've been like hit on all sides by opposition. And so then as I looked, you know, I saw this light just envelop everybody. But as I looked closer, it was a white hot flame that was just encircling each person. Wow. And then I heard the Lord say, my fires refined you as you were bowed in worship. So the fires were refining you while you were in your cave, your pit, your prison, your desert, whatever place you've been.
Oh, hey, Terry.
So you were refined by his fire in that season because you were bowed down. You were bowed in surrender and worship and letting him, you know, kind of burn you in that moment. But now he says, my fire is burning you as you stand for war, because it does not matter where you're at, whether you're in the cave or whether you're stepping into your purpose, you're going to be battling. And right. There are people in the season, they don't want to battle anymore. And there's just a real reality to that. But here's the thing, here's what he says. As you begin to step into all I have purposed and called you to do, yes, the heat is intense, but my heat is keeping you protected and pure. So look down. Your feet are moving. The scenery is changing. I think some of us have gotten kind of tired of the same old scenery. You are moving away from this cave. So do not fear. I am the one that calls you ready. Don't wait on anybody else to call you ready. You listen for the Lord. He's calling you ready. And I have readied you, and I am with you in it all. And I just really felt very, very strongly that a lot of you have forgotten that fire is not only surrounding you, protecting you, and keeping you where you changed in the cave. Now you are that new person outside of it. And it's like a guard, you know, and it's going to keep you protected. Yes, you're going to kind of feel the opposition come against you. You're going to kind of see those fiery darts being shot at you, but he's standing with you. He's protecting you, and he's going to keep you pure and protected as you continue to move forward. You know, you always hear that old saying, you know, new level, new devil. Well, the devil doesn't change. He just tries to change his tactics to make you think it's different. Absolutely. To make you think it's different. What's happening is that fire that's outside is now burning within, and it's not going to stop you. It's not going to change you. You're not going to go backwards. I just really felt like someone needed to hear that. You're not going to go backwards. You're not going to go back to where you came from. You know, there's always going to be moments where you have to retreat into the quiet. We've talked about this before. Mm-hmm. You have to keep your focus. And but you're not going to go back. He's moving you out. He's moving you forward.
Well, and I think the big thing that with, along with what you're saying, first of all, like when we do lose our strength and we do lose our focus, you know, God isn't mad at us for doing that. He actually draws us closer and pulls us in, but he also places around us, you know, those that can help us through. And I know so often you had to remind me of all of these things just in the last 3 weeks. I mean, when I say that, I'm literally talking the last 3 weeks since September 1st. And you had to remind me many times. And normally, like, you know, there have been a few times where Marty's been the, you know, the stronger one, but I'm usually the one that's, let's pray tonight, let's do this, let's do that. And I literally have felt like what you were just talking about of literally throwing in the towel, giving up, and just falling into, you know, a ball. And, you know, you kept reminding me of that. And, you know, luckily, you know, it's so wild about the burning bush thing that you were talking about, because just, you know, I just wrote on this the other day that I just thank God I ran to the dollar store quickly before this broadcast. And on my way there, you know, I was thanking God again, actually, for everything that's taken place in the last 3 weeks because of what happened to Marty this week. You know, it literally had to put him in a place where he was the one that was going to God. He was the one wanting the encounter. He is the one that walked to the burning bush, and he is the one that met Jesus there and heard the voice of the Lord tell him that everything was going to work out and everything was going to be okay. And I mean, when something like that happens, and we're all seeking those moments, I know I've had them myself, but, and a lot of times now mine are more in signs and wonders than that booming audible voice. But I think the way that Marty said, like, it wasn't that whisper, it wasn't a sign. It was literally, I was looking around for the other person in the room, and you know, he would have no, you know, he's so happy about this. He's like, yes, tell whoever you want to tell, because he's so overwhelmed that it is that, that profound interaction with God that just places us on our knees and sets us in a thankful place when we're in our worst place. And he had that, and it's brought him just to tears of joy in the last 4 or 5 days. And so, you know, I'm almost thankful for this, but in that, in all this, I'm kind of circling back around to, that was what you were starting to talk about, you know, and then when you're talking about purifying us, it, I can see, you know, the attacks that have come against us, whether it's been, you know, me physically or different things going on with us, that it is. I mean, we've had to watch our own behavior. We've had to watch our own actions. We've had to watch our own language, as far as like keeping it within the language of love and caring of other people instead of defensiveness, or anything that's just not what Jesus would want us to react in when we're being attacked. I'm not talking about ugly words or anything like that. I'm just talking about the heart. And you know, it's been a horrible roller coaster ride, but I'm so grateful for where he's brought us, and I'm so grateful where he's brought Marty, that I think from this moment forward that we will walk more in that purity that you're talking about together. Each one of us have gone through our own fires, but it's nice to, I feel like now, you know, if you're walking through something either with a ministry partner or a husband or coworker or whatever, like Marty is my partner in life. He's my business partner. He's everything. I feel like now we're in the same place stepping forward, if you know what I mean. Like we were walking together, but we weren't in step as far as having that same, like, what am I trying to say? As far as knowing God's presence is right there. And I feel like until you have that, you can't walk at the same, you know, pace at in step. And does that make sense to what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And now yeah. I feel like every step forward from this point, like Marty and I will be, I'm sure something will trip one of us up at some point, but it's taken a long time to get to this, and I think that this was the final thing, that God was ready for this breakthrough that I thought was happening 3 weeks ago. And I think he took this opportunity that we've come up against all these things to refine it. And I don't know about you, but when we're in these moments of refinement, the things that we have to do, like for me, the first thing is to release.
Yeah.
It's not throwing up our hands in defeat, not throwing, you know, up our hands and walking away or throwing in the towel. It's the release of everything, you know, release of our time, release of each of our days, everything that's going to come and transpire in each one of those days, you know, whether it's going to be an attack, and it doesn't mean to like stand there and take, you know, take the arrows without defending yourself, but it just means allowing God to work through each one of those things and allowing him to process you, I guess, you through it, you know, and, you know, release our resources, release, you know, our need for the resources. And that's just been a big thing with ours as far as timing. Release our troubles, release our worries. What's Candy saying? She says, no, you don't have to get tripped up again. You are there and labored for it. Tell the devil. I'm sure I can't get that open, but, you know, and others can, you know, we have to release others too, you know, in that time. And, you know, and it's not in a bad way, but, and sometimes it's just releasing others in the way of just stepping back, just like me stepping back and saying, you know, luckily we're kind of in step with one another to the effect that if one of us needs a break or something like that, you know, it doesn't bother the other person. But I was just so grateful that you were willing to allow me to step back, because I truly needed to for some of those weeks there, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know,
it's that being in sync. That's is synchronicity
in sync.
Not the band. But yeah, you know, there's, you know, when the Lord's like connecting you with people, he puts you with the people that are, you know, in that same rhythm, you know, it's a dance, and it's a trying to find the words to articulate it. It's a deep level of understanding of those that he's placed around you and what they need, mm-hmm. From you without even speaking it. And sometimes, you know, like we talked about this before, like, you know, there's people that are walking in the depths of grief. And when they're doing that, they don't need a bunch of eloquent words. They just need someone to sit there,
right,
put your arm around them and go, I'm here.
Yeah.
Sit in silence. I mean, that sometimes your silence in the midst of those moments are the most comforting words you'll ever speak. And, you know, and so, you know, you need that. And, you know, and when you're in the midst, like, I think another thing that I really felt the Lord wanting to speak tonight was just the unity in whatever season we're walking through, whether it's in, you know, an advancement or if it's in, you know, in the battle, you know, whatever it is, you know, I'm sitting here and I'm like, you know, everything has a purpose. You know, I've said this a long time. Everything has purpose for your purpose. And, you know, we know that no tear we shed is ever wasted. Everything that, you know, we make a mess of, you know, the Lord comes in and makes something really quite beautiful out of it. You know, all of these things. And as I was sitting here thinking about just, you know, the real intense battles that Anne Marie and I have been kind of going through, and when we've had each other to kind of bounce things off of. And as we were talking earlier today, you know, I instantly started having like two stories like playing out in front of me. I was reminded of the movie Wonder Woman. I absolutely love that movie.
Oh, yeah.
But that scene, it, call me a crybaby, call me super sensitive, whatever. But every time this scene comes up, I get so choked up because I can't help but parallel it to just God and his awesomeness and my life and all this. But anyway, so it's the scene when they're in the trenches, walking through the trenches, and Wonder Woman's like getting really upset. Like, she's like, we have to do something. There are people dying. Like, she's the only, it's like, she's the only one that gets it. And I feel like there's a lot of us in the church, you know, we individually as the church, we are being awakened. You know, the Lord, I've been talking about this for months, you know, how the awakening of the church, and we are being awakened, and we're sitting here saying there are people dying. And we're looking at all of the people who have resigned themselves to the trenches of this is what life is like. They're dressed for war. They've got a gun in their hand and they're doing nothing. They've resigned themselves to the trenches. And as us, the church, are awakening, we're saying there are people dying. And so then she takes off her cloak, puts on her crown, and goes into no man's land. She's going into a place that everyone else was afraid to go, because she had that boldness. She had that fire within her of, I don't care what it costs. How many of us are willing to lay down our pride, our self-righteousness, right, all that stuff, to step into a place where no one will go to help save somebody who's dying? And, you know, and she just tears through that battlefield, you know, all of the bullet, you know, all the bullets are just being slammed aside, you know, I mean, everything was blocked. None of them hit her, you know, and the victory came. And as I was kind of being reminded of this scene, it was also kind of paralleling to David and Goliath. And I know I've talked about this one before too, in that you had men, the Israelites, cowering in their tents, again, dressed for war, but cowering in their tents to the verbal taunts of one giant, a massive army cowering in their tents about the, you know, with the verbal assault of one giant. And then you've got the shepherd boy who has this amazing relationship with God and says, he's not going to curse my God like this. I'm just going to go out there and he's going to take care of it. You know, both scenes. I mean, this is the awakening of the church. We are saying, my God's bigger. There are people dying out there. This isn't going to happen. And those of us who are awakening, that fire is in our bones, you know, and any type of fear that we have has been burned away by our burning bush encounters. And we're going out there because there are people dying, and this just shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. And, you know, and I say all that, sorry, in a long-winded way, to come back and say, as we go through these battles, we aren't supposed to be on our own.
Right.
Just charging ahead, trying to make the battle go quicker to get it over with. There's something to be learned in the midst of that. And also to see that we aren't the only ones on the battlefield. It, you know, if we're ahead of the troops, our job is to take what we've learned, go back, no man left behind.
Right.
You know,
right.
That's the whole purpose of this broadcast, really. No man left behind. You know, we've been through some really intense battles, and we're just like, you know what? I'm not going to shut up about this. We're going to go back. We've been through this battlefield, in this battlefield, in some really intense things over the last few weeks, but we're not going to leave the battlefield as is.
We oh, stop, Roxanne. It was not. Say,
no, was it really? Awesome.
That's so cool. I love the Lord. That is so cool.
That's awesome.
That is so
cool. But, you know, I don't want to leave anybody behind. And if someone's in the midst of just that heavy darkness that hits you sometimes on the battlefield, I want to come in and give you my hand and some encouraging words and some prayer or whatever it is that you need, because I'm not going to leave you there. Anne Marie's not going to leave you there. You know?
You know, and we actually did have that conversation. I'm sitting here and I'm having a flashback of the traffic light I was at when we were having this conversation, and I was just like on Voxer, and I was like, I would literally walk from here to where you are in the Midwest if I needed to walk, you know, if you needed me. I mean, I absolutely would. And I think that's, if we go back to, you know, that Burning Bush article that we wrote, you know, and we're talking about that purity, we're not talking about just saying we would do this.
No.
You know, and that's where, when we talked about the artificial and the real, you know, and I had used that crazy, you know, comparison of Diet Coke and Coke. And when you, you know, you can be saying the right thing, you know, you can be the real thing and be the Coke and be saying everything true from your heart. And then there's this Diet Coke over here that has the artificial sweeteners, and everything is artificial. And I think that that has been a big lesson learned for me. I love people. I absolutely love people. But are all people truly, really loving as well? You know, and I've kind of had to have some discernment there of who to trust and who to stand with. And not that you don't like anybody or there's any kind of, you know, it's more of, you just know that there's a trueness, a realness with the people that you're with, and you can trust them. And I think that's the word I'm trying to get to. You can trust the real thing, and you can discern the real thing. And so if you're around those people, that's, you know, that's what we're looking for. We're looking for the purity from the fires that give you the real heart of Jesus. You know, it's the heart of Wonder Woman that had her go back into those trenches for those people. Mm-hmm. And it's the heart of us as the body of Christ that has to go back in the trenches for the people. And we can't be the heart of Jesus Christ if we're spewing artificial words and we're not living up to what we're saying.
Yep. Yeah, I think there's been so much fluff and stuff that's been put out there, those, you know, that all that feel good stuff. And, and I'm not hating the fact that it feels good or that it's enjoyable to hear. I mean, we all love sweet things, but, you know, Jesus's love was not sweet all the time. You know, I mean, what was that? I saw this, I think I shared it a while back, but it was talking about, you know, everyone wanting to flip the tables in the temple like Jesus did, but no one's willing to die on the cross for those people the way Jesus did.
Right.
And there's a purity that's happening with those who are settled in surrender. That has been a big phrase for me this year, settling in surrender. And I'm telling you what, that phrase has not been an easy one for me to swallow sometimes, because I don't, you know, I'm stubborn that way, you know, but there's that pure focal point that I have is I want the Lord to burn me, so there's none of me left.
Yes.
I want what I say to be His words. I want my actions to be His actions. And it may not be cutesy fluff and feel good stuff all the time. You know, I'm going to be real. I'm going to be raw. And, you know, I may fall apart and cry on a live broadcast, but that's the Lord moving my heart, because I'm seeing so many people trapped in the vices that I was trapped in. You know, I was worried about what other people thought of me. I was worried about my inability to speak on camera, because you know, I'm like, I'm a stuttering Moses, you know, I need somebody else to talk. And, you know, but the Lord is like, no, it's because of your weakness that I make you strong.
Right.
I'm putting my word out. That's not your words. You don't got to come up with them, you know, and I'm so, it's not a lack of tolerance for people, because I love people and I look for who they are. I ask the Lord to give me His eyes to see people with. So we're all broken, you know, right. We're all broken, all in need of a Savior. I shared that the other day, you know, but I've come to a place where I have a distaste for the impure. You know, it's like, I'm tired of people, not for who they are, not for who they were created to be, but I'm tired of seeing people seek things that Jesus didn't seek. You know, they want to do this, that, and the other, and that might be their calling and everything, but it's the striving, that spirit of striving that you see attached to their movements. And you know, Jesus didn't seek a pedestal. He didn't, you know, I mean, the highest elevation he was ever at on this earth was the cross. You know, mm-hmm. He spent his life going into the deep, dark places that everyone was too judgmental to go into. And, you know, and maybe that's part of my calling. You know, I feel called to go to those dark places, to talk to those people that know, you know, that everyone's spending their entire lives trying to avoid, you know, and maybe that's just me, but I have such a craving for the pure, mm-hmm. The pure in spirit, the pure in their words and in their actions. And if I'm craving it, I can't imagine how the rest of the world is. You know, the world sees all this stuff probably more clear than those in the church do. And if I'm in a place where I'm craving the pure, that I want to be that, I can't imagine how much the world is craving the pure too. And, you know, we keep talking about, you know, this harvest time and, you know, the billion souls and all of that stuff, but, you know, the billion souls aren't seeking an auditorium and a stage. They're seeking someone that's real. That's just going to say,
yeah,
man, I'm going to walk into no man's land with you.
Yeah.
You know, I'll sit down in that trench with you, whatever it takes for you to see who you were created to be.
Yeah. And I was trying to read what Jerry had put down here, Jerry Roberson. But I can't read the rest of the comment to find out what that was. But I think you're saying that you're struggling with trying to do these, that you're not feeling drawn to do them right now. And I think if that's what you're saying, like Amy and I get that, like, you know, sometimes you are drawn to do these things. Sometimes you do want to get in on here and have these conversations, or maybe you want to do the teaching or prayer videos. For Amy and I, it's having conversations with others about these things. And sometimes you feel led to do them, and sometimes God's is leading you to do something else. And, you know, I know over the last, you know, 2 months, while I have not been feeling drawn to be on here, but drawn into the quiet with him, I've also been drawn to do other things that I'm not typically doing too. Some one-on-one things with some different people that I've been in contact with. So he will pull you away of some things that you would typically do, some things that you think are his vision, and maybe they still are, but he's just pulling you away from the desire to do that right now because you're needed somewhere else. You know, yeah. We can have our, you know, when you're talking about, I hope someone sees my comment about Wonder Woman. That's awesome, Aubrey. I did see that go by. But you know,
I was too busy.
Sometimes I yell at her to stop and sometimes I don't.
Sorry.
No. Sometimes we're given our papers of where we're supposed to go. If you're looking at the war fields and things like that, and you're speaking of Wonder Woman, and I'm thinking of soldiers, and I keep having the picture of one of those movies, and it's that really, really long one that's so good. I think Matt Damon was in it, and someone had to go back near a tree.
Saving Private Ryan.
Yes, thank you. Yeah. And carry a gentleman out, and that's what keeps flashing through my mind. But when we're talking about that, we'll have our papers to go somewhere, but when all hell breaks loose and war happens, we end up somewhere else. If we're enlisted in the war, in the army or the Marines or something like that. And so that's what we are here as well. We may think that we're in, you know, we've been enlisted to do this, but at times I cannot think of the word I'm trying to use. which is usual for when I'm on broadcast. But these things are changed for us, and we have to go with the directions and the plans that we're given in that moment. You know, something I wrote down, you know, his vision is our vision because he gave us our vision. So it goes back to him, and it will always, you know, it may just be a different level of that vision. You know, right. It comes in different levels. I don't know how many times it almost seems like we hear and see the same thing about a vision, and then we both hear and see it change almost immediately that exact same time. It's almost like we're Paul parrots of one another when things like that come up. And I think that's how we know that we're in this ministry partnership, because of that. But we're willing to veer to the course that he wants to take us, because it will build to that ultimate vision of where he wants to take us. You know, we just have to be willing to step off and do the other things that in our assignments. That's the word.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, as we continue to walk in our purpose, I mean, we are already, you know, in our purpose.
Right.
It's, you know, hitting different milestones within his plans as we're walking through that, you know, and each time it gives us a different strategy. We're learning something new. We're getting rid of something that we need to get rid of. You know, and that's been like my whole journey this year has been those burning bush encounters, because, you know, when you look at the story of Moses, after he had that encounter, he was not the same. And I've had multiple burning bush encounters, and it's just because I keep asking for them. I just keep asking, you know, it scares me to ask. I'll admit it. It scares me to ask. It's like, what else are you going to reveal? You know, and that can be scary sometimes.
But that's, you know, our purpose, there's purposeful moments in our purpose. And like what you were saying, we're always walking in our purpose, but there is that destiny, that thing that he wants to take us to, that we are purposed to get to. But we were saying about, you know, I look at Marty's week this week, and I just think he is forever changed from literally a 30-second encounter that will just ring in his ears and in his heart and in his spirit for the rest of his life. You know, and I think of the different times that that's happened to me, and it just takes you to another level of commitment to continue to step forward in this purpose, you know, mm-hmm. and it gives you that another level of commitment to run back and carry the others that are purposed in his will, you know. Yeah. Each encounter brings us to that, how could I ever not do one more thing for God when he has done this much for me?
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly. And you know, and like we were talking about, not leaving anyone behind, because when you have that shift and that realization, you're like, how can I not make sure someone else gets that? You know, like, I want other people to have that reality and that understanding, that revelation of him. And, you know, I was sharing with Anne Marie earlier today, as you know, I got hit pretty hard, I guess 2 weeks ago now, but even in the midst of that just real heaviness, I still had like that thread of hope. You know, like sometimes you just forget. When you're really just getting beat down, you lose sight for a few minutes, you know?
Yeah.
And in those moments, I still cracked open my Bible, and the Lord took me to Zechariah 9:11-12. I've loved these verses forever, but this time around, it just stood out. You know, certain wording in it stood out differently to me. So verse 11 says, as for you, and then I highlighted this, because of the blood of my covenant with you, And for some reason that time, this time around, it just, it hit me really hard. And, you know, and you think about the depths of the blood of his covenant with me individually, right. His covenant with me. What does that entail? Everything, you know, and it just hit me so differently. And then it goes on, it says, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. And then my favorite part in verse 12, return to your fortress, O prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you. You know, return to your fortress. Well, who and what is your fortress?
Right.
You know, it is, you know, if you have anything other, anything else outside of God, you know, it's just going to crumble. But, you know, when you return to him, when you have that, like I said, that thread of hope that I had, return to that little tiny thread, and then his promises just explode over all of that. And then wham, you know, he's brought me right back to where I was before the opposition even came, you know, yeah. And, it, you know, that, like that vision I was sharing earlier, that fire, you know, even though I saw the opposition and I felt it hit, his fire was protecting me. It was keeping me pure.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm still moving forward despite the opposition, you know?
Yeah.
And that he announces, I don't announce, he does.
I mean, a week ago, I literally felt like I was sliding back to 2 years ago. I mean, I really did. I just was, you know, I felt like I was literally, hey, Sarah. Hey, Agnes. Sarah. I saw Agnes.
Hi, Agnes.
And Lisa hopped on too. You know, I literally felt like I had slid back to, and now all of a sudden, like you saw me moving around while you were talking, my, because I had to get on multiple devices to try to make this work tonight. My iPad was sitting on my Bible. I needed my Bible. And then I realized I took the marker out of it when I sat it under my iPad. So my iPad's sitting on a pillow now. But anyway, I was sitting and looking up those verses because remember I was sitting on my porch the other day, Amy, and I was reading to you the verse that said it was like 3 weeks, 21 days.
Yep.
Today's the 22nd. I got a message this morning that literally brought me back to where I was 3 weeks ago. Now, I'm not talking in everything. We have had, you know, a loss in the family. I'm still trying to find out some things medically. But with these other attacks that have come up against us, one message put me back to where I was 3 weeks ago. I didn't slide back two years. In fact, I've come up further than where I was 2 years ago because Marty had his encounter, you know, and then I've seen all of this happen through him. And now I'm exactly where I was meant to be when I walked through September 1st thinking that that was a breakthrough moment. I'm right back there.
Yeah.
So stick it, enemy. Sorry. I just was like freaking out because I heard like you were talking about being, you know, you were coming back exactly where you were. And I'm like, wow. Like I was saying, I was banking on God pulling through with something on the 22nd. I'm looking at the clock right now. It's 21 after on the 22nd. There's 11 viewers right now. And that's all I had for days was 11 or ones and twos. And I just knew something huge was coming. Huge.
Yeah. Yeah. I've had the twos all day today. Like every time no matter where I was looking at, it didn't matter if it was a clock or a license plate or what it was. It was twos, two, 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 twos. And I'm like, okay, well, that's kind of cool.
Yeah.
But he took me back to the verse that you know, I've just been stuck on the whole like fire purification, all that stuff for quite a while now. But he brought me back to that verse that I shared. My timeline is all just like a blur. But it was Isaiah 6 verse. I just opened it up in my Bible. Verse 6. Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it, he touched my mouth and said, see, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. The verses that I was praying before all this opposition came was this verse, burn me, Lord, burn my mouth, burn my lips, purify me, and, you know, use me however you plan, you know, mark me, use me however, you know, I'm here, send me. And then whammo. And the enemy's like, I'm going to shut you up for a little while. You know, and there were days where I'm like, you know what, it really feels like he's being quite successful. But even in the midst of feeling as though the enemy is winning, the Lord was just showing me, no, you were still clinging to me. You were still praying those prayers. And, you know, and he announces, he declares, he protects, and he fulfills all those things that he says, and, you know, over you, that even in the midst of the opposition, you prayed a prayer that was in his will and his purpose over your life. He's going to do it.
Right.
And so in the midst of that heaviness, I still felt, you know, what I was praying, that fire, you know, burning me. And once things kind of started getting to a place where we both were kind of coming out of it, and we were talking about, oh, we really need to, you know, get back on and do this broadcast and talk about this, because there are so many other people, you know, in the midst of this.
Right.
I'm telling you what, as soon as we made that agreement, I just felt like this, whoosh. Not to sound stupid or cheesy, but I mean, I literally just felt that raging fire once again. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so awesome. And, you know, I can't get away from it. You know, like once I, you know, what I once feared and rejected, I now crave, and, you know, and I need it. And I want to like speak that over everyone else. Like the things that you fear are going to be switched over and taken away and turned into something that you see the Lord working in, and then you're going to find your purpose within it.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, the enemy loves to use fear, and I was terrified, still am to a degree, of speaking, like public speaking. I'm terrified of it, but the Lord keeps pushing me to do that. And, you know, so what he's done is he's taken my fear and he's flipped it to, by placing a message and a passion and a burning within me that is so much deeper I'm losing the words to articulate right now. Sorry. The message that he's given me is more powerful than the fear I have of speaking.
There you go. Yeah. And I mean, I think I've said that before for an instance, back when Marty and I were going through his depression, when God literally said to me, is your fear of Marty bigger than your trust in me? You know, so,
yeah.
You know, you were, when we look back at the burning bush moments, you know, and we even mentioned this back in July, you know, when he comes through these things, we have to know and understand he is going to level those mountains. He is going to part the sea. He is going to, you know, breathe life into those dry bones, even in the worst circumstances. And we're talking some of those circumstances I just mentioned were the absolute worst circumstances. So you have to get to those worst circumstances to see, you know, him come through for you. And it's when he comes through for you that we can give him the glory. I mean, you were talking about the scripture that you were soaking in. And when I said I went to David 12, and I'm like, you're like, what? And I'm like, I mean, Daniel 12. And I can't remember what that was about. But then I was soaking in Jeremiah 30. And it was like every verse made sense. Every single verse made sense to everything that I was going through, you know, whether it was the illness or some things that Marty and I have had come up against us. And you know, in Jeremiah 34, I hear cries of fear. There is terror and no peace. 30, you know, verse 8, I will break the yoke from their necks and snap their chains. I sat on that believing that for the last 3 weeks. Do not be afraid. This is 30:10-11. Do not be afraid or dismayed. You will be returned from your exile to a life of peace and quiet. I think I even posted on that this week. No one will terrorize you. God is with you and he will save you. You know, and then 30:16-17, all who devour you will be devoured. All who plunder you will be plundered, and all who attack you will be attacked. And 18, I will restore your fortunes. You will sing songs of joy and thanksgiving. I will multiply you. I will honor you. I mean, I have literally seen these verses unfold in my very own life in the past 3 weeks. You know, and there are some things that still need to be overturned. There's some still some you know, yokes that need to be broken, some other things that are going on, but I keep seeing it. And it's just like, I'm living in those and I've been reading those every day and believing those. And, you know, I'm just walking out of scriptures.
Yeah. Well, and that's what we're supposed to do. You know, it's called the living word for a reason. And as you were sharing that, I really felt strongly that there's someone or multiple people dealing with like doubt and frustration.
Yeah.
Because their situations have felt dark, that they've felt hopeless, that they've felt as though they're not breaking, and they keep grabbing a hold of, you know, these prophetic words and scriptures as their promises, and yet things aren't still coming to fruition. And let me tell you, I'm still walking through this. Okay. I know, but the Lord speaks it to you through, you know, prophetic words, through his scriptures, and he highlights those to you to hold on to give you faith, to build your faith, to build your hope, mm-hmm. that what he says will be. And I know I've talked about this a lot, our 11:59 minutes, you know, there are times that come and pass that it's like, God, why didn't you answer that prayer yet? It really needed to be done here. This needed to happen here. Why am I still waiting? You know, I mean, trust me, I've said and thought all these things, but at the end of the day, I sit there and I pray and I'm like, I still trust you, Lord. I still have my hope and my faith in you. My life is surrendered to you. And so I just wanted to really like come against that right now, because that is the tactic of the enemy. You know, he did the same thing to Eve in the garden. He came in and he twisted. Mm-hmm. He didn't completely erase what God said. He just twisted a couple of words. And he put in the thought that, you know, that one tree. I mean, God said, you can eat of all the fruit in the garden, just not this one. And the one that he said not to eat from, it was protecting them. What do you need to do with, you know, the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Well, now you know about it all. And so therefore it negates, you know, the life that you could be eating from, the tree of life. It brings in a knowledge of things that don't require you to have faith, you know, and he gives us the free will to choose to have faith in him. And I had this, this word, I knew he was segueing into this for some reason. Okay. This is for somebody. It says to stop running and stop quitting. You want me to move swiftly, but I need your movement in faith. Yes, I can move a sedentary boulder, but I did not give that boulder free will. Step out. The waters will recede. They will not sweep you away. Like, I really felt like someone was just sitting there like, hey, you know, you can do this. I have faith that you can move this massive thing, this sedentary thing. But what he's asking you to do is have the faith to step out, to trust him, to keep moving forward. And if that moving forward is you simply saying, I still trust you. I believe that the words you've given me, the scriptures you've given me, those are your promises and you will fulfill it. Sometimes us speaking that out of faith, even though we don't feel it, even though all we still feel is doubt and fear, is, you know, that's movement. And I really just wanted to to speak that encouragement over you, that even though it feels long awaited, even though it feels like he's late to the game in answering these prayers, not because his timing is perfect and his promises will be fulfilled over your life.
Well, and if his timing wasn't perfect, you know, and everything, I mean, if these things that I needed to happen and believed were happening 3 weeks ago, and it was that time that it was going to happen, if it happened then, Marty would have never had this encounter.
Yeah. There's something beautiful that happens in the pressing.
Yeah.
You know, in that uncomfortable place, you know, whether it's, you know, like we were talking about the burning bush encounters, or, you know, I talked about like the olive press, you know, the whole pressing of the olive to get that pure oil out. It's a process. And, you know, if you were that olive, you're going to be pressed, crushed, bruised, and chopped up, you know, and that's after the tree's been planted and after the years of the tree growing, before it even bears fruit. You know, there's a process and a perfection to everything that God does. And, you know, but we have to be willing. You know, it's our free will.
Right.
He has this massive, amazing plan for each and every one of us, but we have to be willing to allow him to process us to step up into it. You know, like I said at the beginning, you know, I can't go and apply to be a CEO of a large corporation. You know why? Because I don't have the qualifications to apply for that job. But in, you know, and it goes for the same in the spirit, in the church, in our purpose. There are multiple stages of our purpose, but each time we come to, you know, one stage, that's our choice to say, yes, God, burn me, mark me, move me. And you know what? And if you get to a place where you're just done and you want to surrender and you want to stop where you're at, he's totally cool with that because he loves you, but he will still continue to change you because he loves you too much to leave you where you're at. We are all always going to be in a process of becoming who he created us to be. But there is a specific set point where he's going to wait for you to say, yeah, I want more.
Yeah.
Yeah. I want you to take me here. Yeah. I want you to move me here. You know, I want to do what you have for me, you know, here on earth as it is in heaven. There's a purifying process that has to happen, but it's got to be coming our hearts, our free will, our request, because he just doesn't, you know, just blow in and take over. He wants that relationship with us. He wants us to ask him, yeah, Lord, yeah, I want more.
Well, and when you're saying that, like with Marty's encounter this week, when he first came out to the car and he was just beaming and telling me about it, and he was just broken down, just like, you know, I mean, there's true sobbing there of just joy of that encounter where God thought enough of him, you know, to catch his attention and let him know that things would be okay. I need a minute. Sorry.
I'm getting teary-eyed because I'm thinking about just, you know, these encounters that I have walked through just this year, and just each one, you know, it was, you know, like we talked about the altars earlier this year. Each one has just marked me, you know, it's marked me, shifted me. And I've left each place, you know, with that altar of remembrance and sacrifice of like, this is where I laid this down and I didn't pick it back up. This is where, you know, he changed me, you know, and I, you know, Moses was shifted after that burning bush encounter. You know, I mean, he was still a stutterer, but, you know, the Lord brought Aaron, but, you know, he still had the boldness to go and do what the Lord wanted him to do. And then I, you know, I still feel like him being up on Mount Sinai, even though it was getting the law carved into stone, there was something that shifted. His countenance changed. He had to, you know, he had to put a veil over him because the glory of God was so upon him that he had to put put a veil over his face. And I've found myself going, God, you know, that's what I want, his glory to shine so brightly on my face, on my countenance, in my actions, in mm-hmm. my words, that there's just no doubt that I have been changed
from that. And that, yeah, I mean, and that's what I was going to get ready to say, was that it changed. It made this whole level of change in Marty that, you know, and we see that in each other, whether it's you and I or Marty and I or you and Mark, whatever, we see these changes that take place. And it's just such a beautiful thing. You know, we're all at different, you know, stages of our relationship with God. And it was just so cool in that moment. I could see the desire of Marty in Marty to start seeking him more, you know, like we just started this whole broadcast out with, seek first the kingdom. It's going to be that seeking first the kingdom all the time, not just, oh, you know, when you need something or I'm thanking for something. It's in every moment. And I saw that massive change in him, and I knew it was a permanent change, you know. And we were talking about that a little earlier. You know, sometimes, you know, things can seem like it's going to be a change, but then it just kind of goes back to the way it was. And you can see in the burning bush moments, those are changes that there is no going back. You are never the same.
Yeah, because you just can't.
No.
You can't ever go. Once you have taken your shoes off and stepped foot on that holy ground, it shifts something within you that you look back on your life before that, and you're like, I don't want to go back to that. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I experienced that in the natural back when I was 19, you know, walking to that church high and then I wasn't, you know, the whole thing that played out on that Sunday morning, it shifted me. It mm-hmm. changed me, that I did not have a desire to walk out those doors and go back to the life that I had. Now, I missed the people that I had to leave behind in that season, but I didn't, I just couldn't. I knew he healed me of things that no person on this earth could have healed me from. You know, my body had shifted, you know, and I've continued to have moments like that more so over the last probably 4 years than ever in my entire life. But each moment has changed me and shifted me to a place where I'm like, gosh, yeah, I don't want to be who I was 6 months ago.
No,
because I'm different. I'm different than I was 3 months ago. And I don't want to go back to that either. And it has become so life-changing. And I can't even like find the words to like really articulate it, but I want this for others.
Yeah.
You know, like we were saying, I want to turn back and go, who needs what?
You know? Yeah.
How can I help you get here?
Well, because, I mean, when you're talking about changing you in that time, I look back to, you know, I've always had conversations with God. I wrote about that this week, whether I felt they were one-sided or not at different times. And then when I realized he was talking to me in different ways, but the moment that I heard his audible voice, and as Marty said the other day, that it felt like there was another person in the room, there was another person in my car that day, you know, that he said the words that he said to me before I drove upon my parents' accident. And it changed me so much that literally 2 miles later, I was a different person. 2 miles at the other end of that road, when I saw the barricades, when I, you know, went to the accident scene, when I went home to pack my kids' bags to go to my cousin's house, I was changed to the point that a family member even said, who is that?
Yeah.
Who is that? I've never seen her react like this. you know, and they were amazed at it. And it was that change in that moment, and you are never the same. And I don't think I've ever gone back to, you know, not that I was a weak person, but I wouldn't have been able to walk through a moment of seeing my parents in a car accident, seeing my father passed in the road, seeing my mom loaded in a helicopter. I would have never been able to walk through that if God's voice was not resounding in my ears that day, you know, and he knew that.
Yeah.
You know, and he knew yeah. this week when he spoke to Marty in that same way that this would be the moment that he will never be the same. Marty's been getting closer and closer to God over the last few years. And, you know, he had that big burning bush moment, you know, back in 2015, but this was one that is just life altering for him. So,
yeah.
And it's exciting. And it took the last 3 weeks of, thank you for being my Wonder Woman, though. Running back and getting me.
Wonder in some of those moments, though. I mean, really, it was really kind of crazy because we both were getting hit with different things, but we were both getting hit at the same time. And, you know, and we were both trying to communicate with each other, mm-hmm. You know, what was going on. But, you know, there were just some days where I was just silent, mm-hmm. you know, and Amory was like, where are you?
I need you.
But, you know, it was just that I knew if I spoke, I would be speaking things that I didn't want to speak, you know, and I think that also happens when you're in that fire, you know, it's a solitary thing. And it's a thing you know, I mean, you can experience this with other people, but the moments that you really seek, they're intimate.
Yeah.
It's an intimate moment. And it's not something that other people can bring you, you know, you can experience things, at church, you can experience things at conferences that do shift you and they do change you, but they don't even compare to those burning bush moments, in that quiet place, in that, you know, in your prayer closet, whatever you want to call it. Because there's something that happens when the Lord's presence hits you in the quiet that no other person, place, or thing can do. And you know, and I'm not negating any of those great things that can happen, you know, conferences, churches, you know, prayer groups, all that is good, but you can't step away from those one-on-one intimate moments because you're missing out on something so amazing and so pure. Those are the moments that what's that verse? The fire shut up in my bones. I can never remember the exact scriptures, but that is what I've been feeling for several months now, you know, just this burning and, you know, and part of that has brought, you know, some frustration that, you know, I haven't been able to move out and go and do some of the things that I really see, you know, us doing. But it's that, you know, okay, you're preparing me and we'll go do this later, in your perfect timing. But it, these moments wouldn't have come had I not had that intimate one-on-one time.
Right. Well, and, you know, I've talked a lot about the audible voice and you're talking about the one-on-one time. It's that burning bush moment could be anything for anyone. And sometimes yeah. it's through another person. Yeah. And I'm sitting here thinking about, sorry. Then, sorry.
That's all right.
Sorry.
Woo. You're making me tear up, girl. You're not going to be crying alone.
We lost my dad's best friend this week. Uh, they had gone on a cruise. The couple went on a cruise with my mom. It was the same exact cruise that my parents went on 5 years ago this week. And the husband took ill, and I had to get off the ship, and they took him and his wife to a hospital. And you're talking about Wonder Woman. I'm just having a whole different view of my mom right now. I've like thought about this several times this week. Oh my. And I even talked to her friend that she went to see. My mom has like a, I think something's wrong with her knee right now. Walked 12 blocks from a ship in a strange town to get to the hospital. You know, to make sure that her friend was okay and that my dad's best friend, you know, was okay. And my mom went there. And I just think of her as like she was not. I mean, I think my mom would have gotten off the ship permanently if she could have, but unfortunately, she couldn't. And they had to go, you know, life flighted to another hospital, and he passed away. But I think about mom and going to see her friend and the willingness of her to do that. And you're talking people in their 70s, you know? And that's a burning bush moment. I think in a way for my mom and in a way for her friend. In a way for me, you know, you see people that are real and ready to walk through the trenches with you.
Well, you know, and you see those people, they may not physically put on their crown and take off that cape like what Wonder Woman did in that scene, but the willingness that they have to step out into no man's land to go be whatever those people that were in captivity needed them to be, whatever that is for people, that's what I want to be. You're starting the waterworks here, girlfriend. That's, you know, if it's in prayer, if it's an encouraging word, if it's my experience when I come off the mountain, you know, that's what I want, and that's what we are all supposed to be. And, you know, willing to lay ourselves down and share everything we've learned, you know, and help others, you know, put your hand out, you know, and like I said earlier, you know, if it's someone walking through the depths of grief, your silence is the best thing. If just the silent sitting, you know, let, you know, being that shoulder to cry on. You know, someone dealing with depression, you know, just speaking some life and truth into them. You know, whatever it is, you know, someone is struggling with, you know, the doubt and the fear that hits us all the time when we're waiting, contending for promises, you know. And you know, sometimes the Lord does use us to be that burning bush to get that person's attention, because, you know, we are all heavenly funnels anyway. You know, if we're walking in his will, he's going to use us. If we ask him to use us, he will. And he will use us to draw somebody's attention so they actually turn and look at that burning bush moment. And whether it's through you or, you know, your encouragement for them to, you know, have that quiet prayer time, he will use us. And, you know, he's using the nameless, faceless, surrendered lovers of God to step out into no man's land, because we know what no man's land is like. You know, we aren't the big generals standing behind the protected lines. You know, we're down in the trenches. We've been in the battle. We're bloodied and bruised from life, and you know, but the Lord's healed us, and he's sending us in places that a lot of people don't want to go. And you know, you just never know. you know,
there's only what few that will walk, that will choose to go to those places. Not everybody does, you know.
No, most of those places are places that people spend their entire lives avoiding. You know, Jesus went and sat with people that everyone else avoided. Everyone hated the tax collectors, but guess who he went to, you know, whose house did he go to? You know, the tax collectors were traitors as far as the Jewish people were concerned, because they were Jewish people collecting for Caesar, you know?
Yeah.
They were the most despised on the planet, you know? And he went what we would call out of his way on his journey to go encounter one woman at the well. What did that one encounter do for that woman? Mm. You know, it's that whole, he left the 99 to find the one. And there are so many ones out there that feel alone and lost. And the 99 are just gathering their groups and their cliques and their followers and all this BS. Sorry. You know, and I'm sitting here going, where's the one? Where's the one that would complete that group? And, you know, but that's my mentality, because I was the one. I was the black sheep. I was the troublemaker. I was the this, that, and the other. I mean, you come up with the labels, and I probably had it attached to me at some point or another. But, you know, the Lord found me, and he brought me back. And how can you not, you know, go back and do the same when you've, you know, experienced that? And yeah, I mean, it all just shifts.
It does. Whew. I saw Suzanne hop on here. We missed you, Suzanne.
You missed the crying session.
Sorry, I did that.
Oh. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. I could ask anyone that's still on here, you know, to lift that family up in prayers tomorrow. We have the visitation services, and it is very hard. It's a relationship that was a little blessing from God. When we did lose my dad, my dad and this man were so much alike. They almost had the same inflection in their voice, the same mannerisms, and even like held their mouths the same way when they talked. So even my girls sobbed when we've lost him this week, because, you know, it's a little piece of granddad that's gone again.
Yeah.
So be a tough couple days here.
Yeah. Yeah. I found old archived messages between me and my dad this week. So it's like, well, that sucks. Because it'll be his birthday next week, and, you know, the whole year of firsts, that's never easy.
No.
So, yeah, it's definitely been a month for the books.
It has.
You know, we've been talking about and prophesying about, you know, the new year and the new thing and the emerging and all this thing. And although it's all true, you know, we've really had to fight for it. And, you know, the enemy, he doesn't want us walking into it, because watch out, you know?
Well, the funny thing is this week, this month, you know, he's come so hard, the enemy has, since September 1st, that it's, you know, I'm laughing because I'm thinking, I'm just picturing us ricochet that, you know, like, you thought you were throwing us into this place, and we've ricocheted and come out back stronger, you know? Mm-hmm. Yep. And we're not stopping, you know?
Yeah, that's what I was saying earlier. I'm like, you're not going to get me to shut up. You might have had me quiet for like a couple of days, but you're not going to get me to shut up.
Mm-mm.
And, you know, and like I've been saying, even though I didn't feel like it, I wasn't feeling all warrior-like, but I was saying he's going to regret. You know, he's going to regret messing with us on all of these levels, because it's not just one thing. So every single thing that he's tried to mess with, every single thing that he's tried to steal, the recompense, the restoration is always better than it was before. So what we thought we had in our hands before that he tried to steal, we're going to have that and then some.
Right.
Yeah. So.
Suzanne, yeah, I've gotten a message today that some great things are happening. So I have to fill you in on that one, and Terry as well. You know, something I had written down was through all of this, like we're standing firmly, you know,
right, Aubrey,
where we are. And we just have to declare and decree he is all powerful. Nothing will shake us. Nothing will take our eyes off him. Our hope will remain. Our faith will be unshaken. We will not waver. We trust. We will trust him. He is the creator of all things, and therefore he will create all that we need to perform his will, and he will supply all our needs as we step out to do so. You know, he has placed, you know, this his desire in our hearts, and he will bring those to pass, you know, those things that he wants for us to pass. And he's, you know, he has made flesh from dirt, and he's placed the stars in the sky. So he can surely, you know, to be able to do all these things that we're asking of him and more. And he will, you know,
yeah.
And he'll do them in a more profound way than we've ever thought. You know, as I said, you know, I was laying back. I was that person under the tree, and you and Marty took turns coming to get me. You know, when you had to go back in your little cave over there and be quiet, Marty was there running to get me. She needed a break, y'all. No, I just kidding.
You know, it definitely is going to be, you know, above and beyond all that we could ever ask, think, or imagine.
Absolutely.
You know, because, you know, and that verse, that Ephesians 3:20 verse, it always just levels me, because I sit and I think about, you know, just the God-sized dreams and visions that I've already had that still have yet to come. And every time I sit and I think about it, and every time I sit and I pray over those, I just keep hearing, you know, like, that's just the first drop in the bucket, you know, like these huge things that seem so unattainable for us. What he's showing us, that's just the tip of the sword.
Yeah.
You know, that is just the glimpse of what he's giving you. And I'm overwhelmed and in awe of what I have seen. And if what I have seen is only just a glimpse, how much more, you know? And so when I sit and soak on that, how can I be at a place ever where I allow the enemy to push me back? I allow him to knock me down, you know, take the wind out of my sails, however you want to word it. I can't. I mean, he may have pushed me back a little bit over the last couple of weeks, but he didn't get me back anywhere to where I ever was, you know, like he thought he was winning. And, but he didn't. And now, like you said, you know, it was almost like that, you know, the whole, like whatever, that rubber band, you know, snapping back and launching forward, you know, whatever opposition, you know, it's just, it's more of a resistance that when he has to let go, because, well, now he has to let go. I mean, he's been caught. So try another tactic, dude. You know, it's gonna kind of be that launching pad. And, you know, everything that we've been going through, there's a purpose in it. I mean, the enemy may have, you know, tried to do something against us, you know, for our harm, but what he intended for our harm, the Lord intends for our good. And he's going to use every single thing, even in the midst of the darkness, even in the midst of the battles, he's going to use it and move it forward and move you forward, wiser and stronger and further than you thought.
We've been talking about movies, and last weekend, Marty put on that movie Adrift. I don't know if you've seen that or not.
Yeah.
Oh, so good. And it was just bizarre that, I mean, we watch movies a lot, but it was just bizarre that he just all of a sudden said he wanted to watch that one. And like thinking back to it now, and I know that I had some thoughts about it prophetically while I was watching it, but while you were talking, I was picturing the one part where, you know, we didn't know this as we were watching it, but when that big ship came through in the middle of the night after they had been through that storm, and he had obviously passed, but we had thought he was alive at that point. That big ship was coming through and she was hallucinating, you know, and the enemy will so often, when we are shaken to our core and, you know, down for the count and weak and crying out, will show us these things that aren't real. Just like you were talking about in the Garden of Eden, you know, he'll make some things up. He'll throw these things, hallucinations out in front of us that make us believe that our circumstances are worse than they are. And, you know, you can look at that ship as she thought it was someone that could save her, and they left her and they kept going. They passed her by. We were talking about that tonight, you know, or she thought, oh my gosh, you know, I'm going to be steamrolled here by this big ship and I'm going to be taken under. And the enemy can place so much fear in us with something that's not even real.
Yeah.
And we can make it so real. You know, my daughter's been going through some different things with anxiety, and it acts up at night, and she gets really wound up right before bed. And it's like the enemy knows that that's when he can stir it up. It's dark, you're alone, you become fearful, you know, and he does it to us, whether it's our finances or whatever, whether it's a kid's anxiety about, you know, studies or friends or whatever it is, you know, he'll try to do that, and he'll make our problems so much bigger. Marty goes, whenever I start to go at like 12:30 at night and I'm like, but tell me everything's going to be okay. And he's like, just go take a melatonin. Just wake up in the morning and you know it'll be better, because he's attacking you right now. You know, yeah. And what you're seeing is not real. So,
yeah.
Whew, it's 11:04, sister.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Well, we knew this would go long.
Yeah. Yeah. I've heard my kids, I was wondering, could you hear the toilet flush in the foyer from my room during the, could you hear that?
No.
Because they're going to the bathroom that's on the other side of this wall. But we have to get up. I have a parent meeting. They're getting confirmed soon and they have class in the morning and everybody has church services.
yeah.
So I guess we should go. It's a big day, y'all. I got to pick up my mom. Yeah. You know, she had to stay on the cruise ship. I have to pick her up tomorrow. And then we have some services tomorrow evening. So definitely would appreciate your all's prayers through, you know, I could say that a couple days, but it's going to be wow, close family friend like that. So I appreciate that. Everybody right. Stay strong, stay strong. And Amy and I are here to run back and get you. And, you know, I wish we could, I wish this Facebook Live was a big old Zoom conversation.
You know, we could get everybody on there.
That's right. Thank you, Aubrey. So.
Yeah, thank you, Aubrey. Let's just quickly pray. I wanted to pray for Aubrey really quick. And everyone else, Aubrey, you're having some thyroid issues.
Whoa.
And dealing with some PTSD. So Father, we just come before you. We lift up Aubrey. Lord, I just want to speak your peace into Aubrey's life right now. All the effects from the trauma in the past, Lord, we just relinquish those from the enemy. The fact that he thinks that he can keep bringing these things up, although there's true trauma, Lord, you are the true healer. And we ask that you just come in and heal her body, her mind, her spirit. Give her your peace from the top of her head to the bottoms of her feet, Lord. And we speak against anything that's coming to her thyroid, all thyroid issues, actually. We just command all sickness to leave, that the thyroids return back to their original design. Healthy, healed, and whole in Jesus' name. And Father, as we leave this broadcast tonight, we just ask for you to come in and invade our space, invade our time, encounter each and every one of us like you did with the burning bush and Moses, Father. We want you to burn us. We're asking you to mark us and move us. Show us the things that you want us to see. May we hear everything that you want us to hear. We ask for you to invade the dreams, Lord. I just felt like someone has been asking for some dreams, that maybe your dreams have died, Lord. So we just speak life into the dreams for those that have been seeking that out. Whatever is attacking them in the night season, Lord, we come against that in your name. We speak peace and light into their rooms and around their homes. Everything that is invaded that is not of you has to leave right now in Jesus' name. Someone dealing with like back or neck issues, I don't know if it's like a pinched nerve or a disc that's moved out and you've like lost mobility. I want to say it's like on the left side, like in your shoulder muscle area. Whatever it is, whoever it's for, we just speak healing to that right now. Everything has to be aligned, put back into place. All things that are pinched, be loosed and return back to normal. No more dysfunction, no more pain, no more headaches. In Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe it's stress or tension, but we're just going to command some peace to come into that situation as well. If there's a situation that's causing that to come over your body, our bodies are made to respond to our environment. And so our environment now is going to be the Lord's peace, and nothing is going to come in and steal that from you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Amen.
Aubrey, I will be praying for your thyroid. I will be going in for some other tests this week myself on that. Keep getting one more step to take. So I'm praying whatever is going on with yours is healed. And because I know mine's taking a toll on me energy wise. And, over the last month, I even was struggling with talking a lot. It was straining and hurting. So hopefully.
Yeah. Even though it may be a process, we're still going to claim the healing and the sports are going to come back.
Yes.
Normal.
Yes. Healed. Yes. May it all be resolved. And may it all happen in a timely manner, because we all know waiting for these things to happen and trying to line everything up to get them done. You know, we're just praying for that as well. If you have any tests or anything going on like that this week, Aubrey, any appointments, any answers that you're waiting for, I hope and pray that every single one of them come in a timely manner so that there is no waiting involved.
Amen. Amen. All right. Well, thanks for popping on. Yes. And I know we're going to plan on doing these more often.
Yeah. We're coming back.
We will definitely be back sooner than later.
Yes.
But you know, like we've said before, you know, we only do these when the Lord speaks and tells us to do these. And as much as we want to have them planned, you know, sometimes it just doesn't happen that way. And we just, you know, back to the whole purity thing. That's what we want to strive for. And that's what we want to stick to, is just the purity in our words and in our actions, and speak when the Lord wants us to speak and be quiet when he wants us to be quiet. So love you guys.
Love
Thank you so much for joining in with us, and we will be back soon.
Yes. Love you.
Love
Bye-bye.
You. Bye. Bye.